discuss the management of severe sepsis and septic shock. This is very, very important because about 20% of admissions to intensive care in India are because of severe sepsis or septic shock, and about 25% of them are going to die. So the objectives for this talk are: we'll define severe sepsis and septic shock, the overall management of sepsis as per the surviving sepsis guidelines, what is the importance of imaging and source control, the principles of antibiotic strategy in sepsis as per the surviving sepsis guidelines, couple of examples of how to select the antibiotic, and then I will summarize the topic. Now, how do you manage sepsis in general? So we are just going to have a brief overview as per the suggestions of surviving sepsis guidelines, how to manage a patient with severe sepsis and septic shock. So the executive summary says that early goal directed resuscitation of septic patient using a fluid boluses. The initial bolus may be 30 ml per kg, which may include albumin. So the suggestion is to use crystalloids, but you can use albumin if too many crystalloids are required. Collection of blood cultures before antibiotic therapy. Imaging studies to identify or confirm the source of infection or suspected source of infection. So for example, if you think the patient has got pneumonia, you will do a directed study and do a chest x-ray or a CT scan. Administration of broad spectrum antibiotics within 1 hour of diagnosis. Then reassessing the antibiotic therapy with microbiology and clinical data to narrow coverage to avoid antibiotic resistance development. As per the clinical response, you will continue antibiotics from 7 to 10 days. And nowadays people also use the procalcitonin levels to discontinue antibiotics. Perform source control with a procedure which will cause least physiological upset within 12 hours of diagnosis. Then they suggest that we continue the fluid challenge till there is hemodynamic improvement as assessed by static or dynamic variables. If the patient remains hypotensive in spite of fluid therapy, you give norepinephrine as the first choice of vasopressor to maintain a MAP of greater than 65 millimeters of mercury. You can add epinephrine if you need another vasopressor agent, or you can substitute epinephrine in place of norepinephrine because it is much cheaper than norepinephrine and there have been no studies which show a difference between the action of the two. You can add vasopressin to norepinephrine with weaning of norepinephrine if tolerated. So vasopressin is used to spare the catecholamine in high dosages. Dopamine may be used in highly selected patients or those patients who are at low risk of cardiac arrhythmias, and dobutamine can be added if there is myocardial dysfunction or signs of organ hypoperfusion despite achieving adequate intravascular volume and adequate mean arterial pressure. Do not routinely use IV hydrocortisone, and if you have to use it at all, and sometimes people use it when the doses are very high for vasopressors, so if you use it at all, don't use the doses more than 200 milligram per day in divided doses. Maintain a hemoglobin between 7 to 9 grams per deciliter unless the patient has got critical coronary artery disease or acute hemorrhage. If the patient develops ARDS because of sepsis, then there are lots of suggestions. So use low tidal volume and limit the plateau pressure. Use higher than rather than lower PEEP. Use recruitment maneuvers. If the PF ratio is less than 100, that means severe ARDS, you can give prone position to the patients for about 16 to 18 hours a day. Give fluid conservation unless there is evidence of tissue hyperperfusion, because conservative fluid therapy has been shown to be better for patients with ARDS. Always have protocols for weaning and sedation, and the sedation should be titrated to specific endpoints, which means that you should be using sedation scales to monitor the sedation. There should be specific endpoints for sedation, for example, some number on the Ramsey sedation scale. Short course of neuromuscular blockade may be used in early ARDS. There is only one study, but they are still suggesting it, and it's not a strong recommendation. Avoid neuromuscular blocker if there is no ARDS, and use semi-recumbent position at all times unless contraindicated. To continue the surviving sepsis guidelines further, maintain blood glucose less than 180 milligram per deciliter. The guidelines say that continuous renal replacement therapy and intermittent hemodialysis are equivalent. So you decide as per the hemodynamic state. So obviously if the patient is hemodynamically unstable, you use continuous renal replacement therapy, otherwise you can use intermittent hemodialysis, use DVT and stress ulcer prophylaxis, feed orally or enterally as tolerated, avoid fasting rather than starting TPN very early, address goals of care such as treatment plans and end of life planning as appropriate in that particular situation. Now we are going to discuss the important things in this topic: imaging followed by source control, and then antibiotic therapy as per the surviving sepsis guidelines, followed by couple of examples about how to select antibiotics. So imaging is required in most patients, because if you are planning percutaneous drainage, for example, you will not be able to drain it unless you know where the source is. It also tells you about directed versus non-directed surgery. For example, just exploratory laparotomy without knowing what you are seeking versus a laparotomy where you have seen that there is a perforation in the abdomen, in the bowel, and you are operating that patient. You can do a plain X-ray abdomen if the facilities are not available. Ultrasound abdomen can be used because it is portable and non-invasive. But the problem with portable ultrasound is that it is relatively insensitive, so you might miss a source in the abdomen if you use only ultrasound of the abdomen. CT scan is very sensitive. You must give oral and IV contrast, though there is a risk that you might have contrast induced nephropathy later in the course of the disease. And for CT scan, you will need to transport, so you need to be very, very careful because these patients are relatively sick and unstable. What about principles of source control? So there are four things that you do when you are trying source control: drainage of the infected fluid connection, if there is a collection, for example, empyema or a pus filled cavity in the abdomen loculated, debridement of infected solid tissue, and the removal of devices or foreign bodies. So for example, for debridement would be pancreatic necrosis which has become infected, or you might have long term devices put in the bodies. For example, you might have a peripherally inserted central line for giving peripheral TPN or partial TPN, or giving chemotherapy. Definitive measures to correct anatomic abnormality, if any. For example, you might want to close the perforation or resect the bowel and re-anastomose it, and to restore the optimal function. So we are going to discuss this one by one. So the principal drainage is that drainage converts a closed space infection into a controlled sinus or fistula. You should always choose a method which will ensure full drainage to minimize immediate morbidity. So you partially drain it, the organisms grow again in the cavity. The method that you choose should affect the physiology minimally, and the anatomical effect should allow later reconstruction easily. The principles when you are performing debridement is that you should perform debridement only when there is a clear demarcation between viable and necrotic tissue. It will also depend on rapidity at which infections progress. So for example, soft tissue infections will progress very rapidly as compared to the pancreatic necrosis, which will not progress very fast, and the demarcation will come much later. And therefore, in pancreatic necrosis, generally late surgery is preferred as compared to the soft tissue infections where you want to debride immediately. The accessibility at the necrotic infection site. So again, the example is soft tissue infections. You have surface bleeding during debridement, you can compress it and stop the bleeding. But you are doing pancreatic necrosis in haste, and then in early in the stage of the disease, then you have chances of retroperitoneal bleeding, which is difficult to control. And what we do is excision or removal of necrotic tissue, which can be done by three methods. One is surgical excision, second is irrigation and drainage, and third is use of wet to dry dressing. So you put wet dressings which, when they dry out, come out with a part of the necrotic tissue, and that way you keep on changing the dressings till the area is debrided. The third way of doing the source control is device removal. So the coagulase negative staphylococci and candida thrive in the biofilm around the invasive devices, and they also remain protected from antibiotics in the biofilm. So if you suspect that devices are infected, then they should be removed, and you should also remove vascular catheters after securing other access. just a little bit about intra-abdominal infections, because they are one of the commonest problems in the intensive care and one of the most difficult to treat. So again, the principle is drainage of infected material, debridement of infected solid tissue and removal of devices or foreign bodies, measures to correct anatomic derangements leading to ongoing contamination. For example, you might have a perforated appendix which you need to excise and close the cecum. The aim is to minimize contamination and prevent or reduce the SIRS response. The approach will depend on site and extent of the problem, and that's why in imaging I said that you directed laparotomy is much better than non-directed laparotomy. It will also depend on degree of localization and physiological stability of the patient. Just remember that all patients do not need laparotomy. You can put pigtail catheter under CT guidance or ultrasound guidance, and that will also sometimes will lead to drainage, and you can immediately perform imaging to see whether that problem is taken care of. So what is important, some controversial issues. What is the role of percutaneous drainage? We said in the beginning that complete drainage is necessary to prevent immediate morbidity. Whether you should do open or laparoscopic surgery, it will again depend on the extent of the problem. Should we do bare minimum? So people do 2 or 3 stage procedures versus primary resection and anastomosis. This will again depend on the physiological stability of the patient. Whether you should leave the open abdomen open or perform multiple serial laparotomies, and there are proponents for both methods, directed laparotomy versus blind laparotomy, as I said earlier. Just remember that it is important to diagnose intra-abdominal hypertension or abdominal compartment syndrome, because that can cause again multi-organ failure. The only place where you will need urgent laparotomy will be resection of dead bowel in intestinal infarction. Now we come to the antibiotic therapy as per the surviving sepsis guidelines. So we are not going to talk about specific antibiotics, we are just going to talk about the principles of antibiotic therapy. So as we said earlier, intravenous antibiotics should be started as early as possible and always within the first hour of recognizing septic shock or severe sepsis without septic shock. The antibiotic should be broad spectrum, and you might want to use one or more agent active against likely bacterial, fungal or viral infection. And you should also make sure that the antibiotic you are choosing has good penetration into the presumed source. For example, if you are going to use antibiotic for a urinary tract infection, the quinolones will work well because they are all excreted in the kidney. So that is also something which we should be taken into consideration. Consider combination therapy in Pseudomonas and Acinetobacter infections. Consider combination empiric therapy in neutropenic patients. Consider therapy for 3 to 5 days. And then de-escalate following results of the susceptibilities. If you have patients who have severe infections with respiratory failure and septic shock, use combination with extended spectrum beta-lactam, aminoglycoside or fluconazole. For Pseudomonas bacteremia, same principle applies. For Streptococcus pneumoniae infections, use macrolide with a beta-blocktum. Start antiviral therapy as soon as possible when suspected, and then obtain appropriate viral cultures and PCR. The antimicrobial regimen should be reassessed after a few days, you should always keep in mind that de-escalation is very, very important to reduce chances of toxicity, development of resistance, and to reduce costs, because broad spectrum antibiotics are expensive. Duration of therapy typically limited to 7 to 10 days. Only continue longer if the response is slow or there are undrainable foci of infection or immunologic deficiency, and if you find out that the cause is non-infectious, stop the antibiotic therapy. Now we will see a couple of examples of how to choose an antibiotic. We know that community acquired pneumonia, the most common cause is Streptococcus pneumoniae followed by Haemophilus influenzae. In 40 to 60% patients, you will not find a cause. In a small number of patients, you might have 2 or more bacteria causing infection. So according to IDSA, if the patient is previously healthy, you can manage the patient on the outpatient basis. The organisms again are strep pneumoniae, mycoplasma, viral and chlamydia. Recommended antibiotics are advanced generation macrolide such as azithromycin or clarithromycin, or you can use doxycycline, but the macrolides are preferred. If the antibiotics have been received by the patient within past 3 months, then you use a respiratory quinolone such as moxi or levofloxacin, or advanced macrolide and amoxicillin, or you can choose the combination of macrolide, amoxicillin and clavulanate. If the patient is sicker and you need to admit the patient, then you can have all the organisms described before, plus polymicrobial infection, plus or minus anaerobes and legionella are all possible. The recommended parenteral antibiotic therapy is respiratory fluoroquinolone such as levofloxacin or advanced macrolide plus a beta-lactam. If the patient has received antibiotics before, the therapy should be as above, but regimen selected will depend on the nature of recent antibiotic therapy. If the patient is even sicker than that and gets admitted to the ICU and he is on mechanical ventilation or septic shock, or two of the three major minor criteria such as hypotension, multilobar disease and PF ratio which is less than 250, then organisms are likely to be against strep pneumonia, legionella, gram negative bacilli, mycoplasma and sometimes even pseudomonas. So what will we choose in these patients? If there is no risk for pseudomonas, IV beta lactam plus either IV microlide or IV fluoroquinolone is enough. If the risk for pseudomonas is present, such as patient being having been to the hospital before within last 3 months, then you need to select a double therapy, and the selected therapy should be anti-pseudomonal beta lactam. So cefepime, imipenem, meropenem or piperacillin tazobactam combination plus IV anti-pseudomonal quinolone such as ciprofloxacin. Triple therapy is selected IV anti-pseudomonal beta lactam plus IV aminoglycoside plus either a macrolide or quinolone. So that is how we select antibiotic for a community acquired pneumonia. If the patient has got hospital acquired pneumonia or ventilator associated pneumonia or hospital acquired pneumonia, then if there are known risk factors for multidrug resistant pathogens, early onset and any disease severity, it is likely to be streptococcus pneumonia, methicillin sensitive staphylococcus aureus and so on and so forth. If the patient has risk factors for multidrug resistant pathogens, then he is likely to have infection with extended spectrum beta lactamases, legionella pneumophila, MRSA and pseudomonas aeruginosa. This should be considered early, particularly with ventilator associated pneumonia. So the empirical therapy depending on the organism will be either ceftriaxone, levofloxacin, moxifloxacin or ciprofloxacin, or ampicillin surbactam or ertapenem. If the patient has got a hospital acquired pneumonia and the possibility of high risk infection is there, that multidrug resistant pathogens are likely to be present, then you should choose an anti-pseudomonal cephalosporin such as cefepime or ceftazidime, or an carbapenem such as imipenem or meropenem, or a combination of beta-lactamase inhibitors such as piperacillin tazobactam plus anti-pseudomonal fluoroquinolone or aminoglycoside plus linezolid or vancomycin if you are suspecting MRSA. The antibiotic selection will also depend on your local flora and what is the resistance pattern in your hospital. Commonest infection in our ICUs tend to be Acinetobacter and Klebsiella, and you will again select the antibiotic according to that. Very often these organisms will be resistant to even carbapenems and you might have to add colistin to this. Okay, coming to community acquired meningitis, the commonest cause in adolescents and young adults are Neisseria meningitis and strep pneumonia. Again, in older adults will be apart from these two, Listeria will also need to be covered when you are giving antibiotic therapy. If you are suspecting viral infection, it will be herpes simplex virus, enterovirus or human chorioamnionitis virus. So the emergency department empiric therapy for adults according to ACEP in patients with suspected bacterial meningitis is a third generation cephalosporin. If the patient is younger than 50, ceftriaxone, cefotaxim. If older than 50, ceftriaxone and cefotaxim, and you also add ampicillin to cover for Listeria. If you are suspecting resistant strep pneumonia, vancomycin in both group of patients, and with both groups they should be giving dexamethasone 10 mg IV before or with the antibiotics. If you are suspecting nosocomial meningitis, most cases will be from after the neurosurgical procedure or placement of a shunt. The common bacteria will be gram-negative rods, from E. coli to Enterobacter to Serratia species, Staphylococci, either Staphylococcus aureus or Staphylococcus epidermidis, and therefore you need to cover the common bacteria that you see with this, common organisms that are seen in the hospital. So your treatments will include gram-positive and gram-negative cover with ESBL. So you will probably use meropenem in combination with vancomycin in these patients. So to summarize, the surviving sepsis guidelines give clear directions for managing sepsis. Imaging helps to identify the potential source and should be performed according to the suspected organ involvement. Source control is very important. The attempt should be to perform a procedure which will disturb the physiology the least, because these patients are going to be very sensitive to even the smallest damage to the physiology. The choice of antibiotic will depend on severity of illness, type of infection, presence of comorbidities, and most important, last and not the least, local resistance pattern, which is also called an antibiogram, which will be given to you by your microbiologist.